Hi, my name is James White. I'm also known on the internet as Preacher James. No, I am not the James White, the Dr. James White that does the dividing line. His middle initial is R. Mine is P for Paul. But I was at one time a fan of his, and I still hold him in respect. Let me just say this. Later on tonight, I'm actually going to attempt at my first ever true video podcast. This is just a response video to his show on February 19th. It was kind of interesting, actually, because the first half of the show had nothing to do with Rob Bell. It had to do with J.D. Hall and his upcoming debate. And ironically, you know, the debate's about, you know, should we keep all of the law or just part of the law? You know, we're basically picking and choosing which scriptures we're going to follow and why. But you could tell that these two people really like each other. They respect one another. And it was an interesting conversation to listen to. No doubt about that. And then he gets to critiquing Rob Bell. And by the way, I am a Rob Bell fan. I really love this book. And if you've never read Love Wins, I highly recommend it. So they start bad-mouthing, bashing Rob Bell, and, of course, first thing they do is, you know, Rob's a little hurt. Rob's a little upset because when you're a pastor, sometimes at a church, you get treated well by some people and you don't get treated well by others. And I think some of that's coming out in what he said in his interview with Oprah. Rob and Kristen Bell did this wonderful interview with Oprah, and fantastic. It really gets to the heart of marriage, being unselfish, being committed to one another. We'll get to that here in a second. But the first thing I noticed was they're bashing Rob Bell because he doesn't take the Bible as the Word of God. No, I believe the Bible to be inspired. I believe I'm not going to get interrupted again. I got interrupted by cats earlier. So the Bible is man's word about God. We have the written testimony of thousands, obviously not thousands, but many, many important people throughout the history of our faith. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, the 12, the judges, and then King David, and you've got the United Kingdom, and then later on with Rehoboam, his grandson, the divided kingdom. All the stuff that happened to the nation of Israel is important to us as an example of what to do and what not to do. And then, of course, we have the Gospels, and many, most people that know the Bible know that the four canonical Gospels are, in fact, the best source of information about Jesus. Even somebody is, oh my gosh, my brain just went blank. The guy from University of North Carolina, I'll think of it here in a second. You know, most people that know about the Bible will say those are the best resource as far as knowing about the life of Christ. We've got letters written from Paul to actual churches, to Christians who were struggling to figure out what to do and how to, you know, what part of Judaism do they keep and what part of it do they not. So, Bart Ehrman. Even Bart Ehrman would say that the first four canonical Gospels are the best source of information that we have about Christ. But it's still man's word about God. I mean, I can make an entire video just about the subject of slavery. But clearly, there are places in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew Bible, that justify slavery, where somebody today would say, no, that's not true. We know that in the book of Leviticus, for example, in chapter 21, there's a verse, it's verse 10, that says that adultery is a capital offense. Nobody in today's society would go by that. So when you start badgering somebody saying, well, they don't think the Bible's the Word of God, so therefore they're not a Christian, I think you need to look at Matthew 7 a little bit closer about judging people. I don't have to give up the name Christian just because I don't take every single word of the Bible literally. Now, I'm going to play this one little part and I'm going to respond to it. Maybe later when we actually attempt a whole show, then I will get into it some more. But this is Dr. White and J.D. Hall. And I guess they're playing a clip of the Rob Bell video with Oprah.
Marriage, gay and straight, is a gift to the world because the world needs more, not less. Love, fidelity, commitment, devotion, and sacrifice.
They put the words up on the screen, and they're very important words. Love, fidelity, commitment, devotion, and sacrifice. This is Dr. White's comments about it.
Immediately, you can't define marriage in this way, in any meaningful fashion. Certainly not in a biblical sense, not in a historical sense. It's a complete capitulation to the argumentation that has already been accepted by our culture, not because of the weight of the arguments, but simply because of the repetition of the arguments, which is a sad thing when people just give in because they've heard the same thing enough times that they're either get tired of the fight or just go, it must be true. But the reason that we can't give in on this is those words on the screen, or wherever the screen went. Love, fidelity, commitment, devotion, and sacrifice. I think you lose all of them when you can no longer define marriage in a biblical sense. That's not love. Homosexual activity, orientation.
Biblical marriage. Sorry. Abraham had multiple wives. Isaac had, he ended up having twins. Jacob had two wives and two concubines. Is that the biblical model of marriage? David, King David, is one of the most holy and devout people in the entire Hebrew Bible. Had multiple wives. So, biblical model of marriage? You might argue a New Testament model of marriage, because clearly in the pastoral letters, Paul tells them that an elder is to be the husband of one wife. You could argue that, but biblical model of marriage? Come on, Dr. White.
Is narcissism. It's being love with a mirror. It's not the love defined by Scripture. It may be very strong, but it's not biblical love. Fidelity? Fidelity to what?
I've heard this argument from Dr. White before, and I used to buy into it, but what he says is that two men that love each other, it's a mirror image. You're in love with a mirror. No. No two human beings are the same, so how could you call that a mirror? You can't. Just because they're two men, that does not mean their personalities are the same. That doesn't mean they think the same. That doesn't mean they act the same. So, sorry, it doesn't work. I think what I'll do is I'll save the rest of it for later and actually do a full-blown program. I actually do need to go run and get my daughters. But the truth is, when two people are committed to one another, love, fidelity, commitment, devotion, sacrifice, the qualities in any relationship, whether it's romantic or not, you should be committed to the people that you care about. And unfortunately, Dr. White does not see it that way. I don't have time to go into all of the reasons why the 6-7 verses that are used against homosexuals aren't. In fact, I did an entire video just on the two from Leviticus. So I may have to do another one to cover the rest. So I'm sorry, Dr. White. Your argument's a little weak today. So, of course, I think that was the show he did on February 19th. So, sorry. I can't agree with you on that. But you do an entertaining show, and I have to give you kudos for that. For more information about me, you can go to PreacherJames.com. Stay tuned. We're going to have weekly episodes. They're going to be an hour long at least, and we're going to have a lot of fun. So hopefully they'll be informing and educational, and they will edify you. So take care, and God bless.